Dear Mr. President, dear Toastmaster, fellow members and guests. Today I'd like to speak about choice. The more choice people have, the more freedom they have. And the more freedom they have, the more welfare they have. This is some kind of a dogma which is so deeply embedded in minds of modern people that most of them, that it doesn't even occur to most of them to question it. Most of people tend to believe that the choice, as seen now by the society, best fulfills the innate and universal desire for choice in all humans. But do all individuals really benefit from such an approach to choice? There are several assumptions. For example, the first one. If the choice is related to a person, he should be the one to make it. This is the only way to ensure that all his preferences and interests will be completely accounted for. But in fact, it isn't true. Let's look through some study held in San Francisco. 7 to 9 year old children were taken to the laboratory and divided into three groups. They had one and the same task to solve anagrams, but the groups had different choices. The first group of children could choose themselves which anagram to solve. The second group of children was told that their mothers had made a choice for them. And the third group of children was told by the assistant which anagram to take. The results were interesting, and the researchers got two types of kids. The first type of kid did their best when they had chosen for themselves, in comparison to the case when someone else had made a choice instead of them. No matter who did the choice, either their mother or the assistant, their performance suffered. And the second group of children had different results. They did their best when they knew that their mothers had made a choice for them. The second best when they chose for themselves, and the worst result was when the assistant had made a choice for them. What does this experiment show to us? It shows that the first assumption holds true only when self is clearly divided from the others. Choice isn't always a private and self-defining art, and if two or more individuals feel their outcomes as intimately connected, they can make a choice as a collective art, and it will be okay. So it's a mistake to claim that everyone thrives under the pressure of choosing alone. The second assumption goes like this. The more options you have to choose from, the more likely you are to make the best choice. In fact, the variety of options has even some negative effects on people. For example, paradoxically, it leads to paralysis rather than to freedom. Some people feel difficulties to make a choice at all when they have too many options to choose from. The increasing number of options increases the number of criteria even more. And then, even if someone overcomes their paralysis and make a choice, they will feel less satisfied than in case of fewer options. Why does this happen? For example, you have to buy something, and you buy something which is not perfect. And what happens is that the imagined alternatives induce you to regret about your choice. And this regret subtracts from the satisfaction you should get out of what you have chosen. And the more options there were, the more likely you are to regret about anything which is disappointing in your choice. So our expectations increase with the increasing number of options. But this example is rather primitive, it's related to buying, nothing serious. But what if choice is related to something really important, something crucial? What if sometimes it's better not to have an option at all and rely on the choice of more experienced people? I'd like to have another example. Right outside Chicago, a young couple was about to have their first baby. And one night when a woman was 7 months pregnant, she was rushed to the emergency room, and the baby was delivered through a C-section and suffered the cerebral anoxia, which is a loss of oxygen to the brain. Unable to breathe on her own, the infant was put on a ventilator. And 2 days later, the parents were given a terrible choice. They could either remove their child off life support, in which case she might die within a matter of hours, or they could keep her with life support. In this case, she might still die within a matter of days, or she could survive, but she would be in a permanent vegetative state, never able to walk, talk, or interact to other people. And the similar case occurred in France. But these two cases are completely different because of choice. While the couple in France, in the case with the French family, the doctors decided whether and when life support would be removed. While in Chicago, the final decision rested with the parents. And it did have a psychological effect on what they felt after. While the first couple was more likely to ask themselves what if, because the imagined alternatives drew some possible decisions of what could happen if they had made another choice. They had this option. And of course, they got responsible for what they had chosen. While the second couple in France was more likely to accept the truth and live further with their experience. So the presence of choice makes us really responsible for what we choose. And sometimes this responsibility may turn out to be beyond one's power. Robert Frost, the American poet, once said, "It is poetry that is lost in translation." But is it really so? Doesn't the translation allow us to create something unique and reproduce the poetry, the beauty of poetry in every single translation? If we speak about choice, there can be a general model which serves a general translation, which serves the needs of everyone everywhere. On the contrary, in every single case, we should realize what choice can give to us, if it can give us hope or it paralyzes our life. And if we learn to develop the appropriate attitude to choice, we will be able to see it in all its complexity and contradictory directions.